Now, we've talked about Google and James Darmore's suit, which here you have Google employees discussing actual discrimination on record. We've talked about Facebook and how they suppress libertarians and conservatives and pro-life advocates. And we've also discussed Twitter, specifically Project Veritas's latest expose on Twitter, wherein not just one rogue employee, as it was previously claimed, is on tape, clearly heard, discussing how they try to minimize discussion from conservatives. And this is being used as a new news aggregate. For crying out loud, countries argue on Twitter. And so this is incredibly important, not just for elections also, but for the battle of the American mind. Joining us right now, James O'Keefe, who is the best-selling author of Breakthrough, his new book, American Pravda, My Fight for Truth in the Era of Fake News, is on sale today. You can go and get it at your bookseller. And Project Veritas's new expose, tons of video. James, first off, always so good to talk with you. How many employees is it up to now that Twitter has, that you have of Twitter on record, and not just former employees, but employees where they talk about minimizing conservative voices on their platform?
Hey, Dana, thank you so much for having me on to discuss this very important breaking story. We've got 10 engineers and executives and former employees and current employees at Twitter headquarters on hidden camera behind closed doors, although we were in open areas where there's no expectation of privacy, so that it was fully legally obtained. They're talking about shadow banning and censoring people, and how that when you tweet something, they'll target you if you're a, quote, redneck. And if you believe in the American flag, they can use keywords to censor your information. They also talk about, and this is just grotesque, this is, I can't even say on the radio some of the things these people are saying, but how they collect and put into a database private sex messages that you might send your significant other, your wife, your girlfriend, and they talk about storing this information, and they have hundreds of employees. Now, Dana, hundreds of employees that go through and, like, voyeuristically browse it and share it maliciously. Mm. And these are not low-level people. These are one guy's a senior network security engineer hired by the CEO, Jack Dorsey, who says on the tape that they have hundreds of people who do this. Now, Twitter is taking this story very seriously. They've just responded last night again, saying, and I'm gonna quote the BuzzFeed here, quote, Twitter did not answer questions about the number of employees who have access to direct messages or the specific of precautions it takes to protect sensitive user data. So, Dana, this is not a right-wing story. It's actually kind of going mainstream right now.
It is going mainstream, and I've seen it also now hitting all of the tech blogs that normally maybe perhaps wouldn't be so much into our way of thinking or viewing limited government, but now they're being forced to discuss this because the implications of this are much more far-reaching than if you're a Republican or Democrat or if you're a conservative or a progressive, because I think now they realize that this really can be used as a weapon against everyone. And that's, I mean, ultimately, I think the doorway is look how they're charging, look how they're treating conservatives, but also look what they're doing with your information and how they are selling you, which is what you were discussing on Twitter this morning.
Yes, they're actually using it for to share with advertisers, and I don't think that, listen, they're a private company, they can do what they want, but that doesn't mean that investigative work should not be done. They can't lie to their users, and all these companies have sort of become digital town squares. We have your audience, most of them, if not every single one of them, either uses Gmail, YouTube, Facebook, or Twitter to communicate. If you draft a private email or a private message on, like, Twitter, privately, one-to-one, to your wife or whomever, and you say, you know, you start drafting that message, and then you delete what you've drafted without even sending it, they actually are saying in these videos that they store that information, including sexual information, and I don't do this, but many Americans send things to your significant other, and there's
Anthony Weiner
that in a database. I mean, it's disgusting, and they haven't denied it. So it's just, all I can do is the Andrew Breitbart playbook is to keep, you know, dropping these clips over and over and keeping the pressure on, which is what we're doing, Dana. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the videos are shocking and they kind of speak for themselves.
And it does get into an expectation of privacy, which you mentioned, because they also had, you also had one Twitter employee discussing whether or not, well, if the DOJ requested information regarding Trump's private messages, would they give them over? And they happily gave them over, which I found incredibly weird, the eagerness of Twitter to work with a law enforcement agency. In my case, I had someone threaten to kill me on Twitter, and the investigator in my case subpoenaed Twitter, and they just ignored it, and they pushed back. They were not interested in working with them or collaborating at all. So it's very situational. And this, the way that they violate privacy and agreement terms, you said it. It is a private business, and no one is contesting that. We're not saying that, you're not saying that it's censorship. I'm not saying that it's censorship. However, don't they have a responsibility, particularly when you use their service? You agree to a particular code of conduct. You also agree to terms of service. Are they liable for violating their own terms within this agreement?
You know, I'm not a lawyer, so it's hard to interpret. I think, though, that language is very ambiguous and very arbitrary. We did put part of the user agreement. They do own what you put into a DM. That doesn't mean that they have license to store, like, for example, underage sexting. A lot of teenagers do this, and it's awful. And for them to give it to advertisers seems to shock the conscience. There has to be some federal or state law that's triggered or overrules their terms of service. But, some people say that the government should regulate them like public utilities. I don't know if that's the answer. I think the answer is just to be informed. I think citizens need to be informed about what they're getting involved in. And that's
right. But,
now, of course, Dana, this is every time I've been on your show, we talk about this, that of course, the triumphs and tragedies of us doing this, no one in the media cares until we do it. And we're forced to do it because they're not doing it. And they were afraid to call the CEO, Jack Dorsey. A lot of these major journalists are friends with these people. They don't want to be looked at as burning their access. And this is what I talk about in this book, American Pravda, which is what is required, the sort of moral courage and the fortitude and the perseverance and the steadfastness of our citizen journalists who spent a year building relationships with these people who are abusing their privileges inside Twitter and taking the risks to do that, Dana, is something I talk extensively about in this book, American Pravda.
Have they told you at all that there's going to be any disciplinary action taken against these employees? Because in addition to this, privacy expectation, there's also the actions of them shadow banning individuals. And some people have said, well, what's shadow banning? I mean, that's when they're basically blocking users from having their content seen, even from their selected online community. And the people don't even know that they've essentially been blocked. Has there been any, have they spoken out about any disciplinary action taken against any of these current employees that you have on tape who are admitting to treating basically customers of Twitter this way?
Yes, the first reaction from Twitter, as you mentioned in your opening part of this segment, was they said that the individual does not speak for Twitter and speaks in an individual capacity. Usually that's code word for he's fired. Now, we haven't heard any official, Dana, any official news that they fired the person. The Clay Haynes also tweeted out the moment the video broke, he said, well, this isn't fun. Another user, Pranay Singh, who's on the Twitter's direct messaging team, he's the guy who said, I'm going to share all your private sex and private part pictures with the with your illicit wives and girlfriends and so forth. He actually deleted his Twitter account. And so all these things, we don't know if Twitter's doing anything, Dana, and I think they're afraid to report that they're firing their people, because once they do that, all hell will break loose in the media, which will be forced to talk about it. But as I speak to you here today, Wired just put up an article, Slate just put up an article. So the cracks are forming in the media who now believe this is a big story.
Yeah, it's trending in tech now, which is very difficult to do if you're someone who's, of a limited government persuasion. But I think that this appeals to a wide variety of individuals. This should be the common ground, at least, that we all come together on. And again, Twitter's a private company, but at the same time, I just find it interesting in this bake the cake era that you don't get that same courtesy with a social media platform like Twitter. So this, there's been the shadow banning, there's been everything else. Have they discussed, is there any kind of safeguard that they have in place? Have they assured you that they've put something up, they've got something in place that's going to prevent this kind of abuse in the future?
No. In fact, the BuzzFeed reached out to Twitter late last night, and ironically enough, they didn't attack me. They said, quote, Twitter did not answer questions about the number of employees who have such access or the specifics or precautions it takes to protect data. They quoted one Twitter person who said, the stuff that was said in the video yesterday where they're talking about sharing your private direct messages with your ex-girlfriends and things of that nature, mm-hmm. they said, quote, technically accurate to a degree. They confirmed what? That the engineers had this access, and then they said, but exaggerated for effect by drunk idiots featured in the Project Veritas video. So they're calling their employees and engineers drunk idiots. But they also confirmed, Dana, that they do have access, but they won't confirm how many of their employees have such access. Again, senior security engineer Clay Haynes at Twitter says that 400 people are paid to look at pictures of a man's you-know-what. That's what he says, quote
wow.
for quote. And that's unbelievable. I mean, and they're not denying it. So now we have Wired just came out with an article in the last few minutes saying that Twitter has a problem. So you know, Dana, that things are really bad, in San Francisco when friends of these networks are coming out and throwing them under the bus.
Google's under attack. Facebook has changed, and they're being heavily criticized. And now Twitter, thanks to Project Veritas. James, before I let you go, your new book, American Pravda, My Fight for Truth in the Era of Fake News. When you first jumped onto the scene, you had done some work prior, but it was really the Acorn busting story and the attack and discussion of media malpractice. This book, obviously, I feel has been a long time coming for you. Tell us a little bit about your book. I admittedly have not read it yet, but I look forward to it. But it's available in bookstores today, out actually today. Today's the sale date. Tell us about your book.
Dana, George Orwell wrote in 1984 that the most essential command of the people in power, the establishment, was to ignore the evidence of your eyes and ears. In other words, don't believe what's behind that curtain. And this book, which I do believe will be read in journalism schools one day, it tells the story of the triumphs and tragedies and travails of independent citizens who take on the most powerful people in power. I've crossed the border dressed as Osama bin Laden, embarrassing politicians, and then I've been detained at airports where people were grilling me and violating my Fourth Amendment rights. We've gone undercover inside the Hillary campaign and gotten her closest associates to resign, forcing the New York Times to put our stories on the front page. We've investigated teachers' union abuses, and now we're investigating Silicon Valley. We've gone undercover inside CNN, the New York Times, and we've had people burned while undercover inside the Washington Post. But in all of these incidents, there are lessons that I have learned, and there are things that I have seen that will shock you about how our media works. And this book is an incredible true story. It's kind of like a rollicking adventure story, and it's a must-read for people who want to understand how the mainstream media lies to you, because you may think it's bad. You have no idea how bad it is. It is literally a propaganda war, and I think it's incumbent upon the citizens, we the people, to take certain measures to fight back. And I don't think we want to replicate what happened in history, like in the Soviet Union. I call it Pravda because the Russian word for truth in Russia was the Russian Pravda. And in that case, what happened was what Stalin created a nation of feckless cowards, all of whom sold out their brothers and sisters to be praised by the Pravda, even though they knew it was false. They were afraid. They were scared. And I think that we have to some force has to fight these people, but we need to know what we're up against. And that's what this book, American Pravda, is all about.
American Pravda, My Fight for Truth in the Era of Fake News. James O'Keefe with Project Veritas. James, always such a pleasure. I'm sure that I'll see you at CPAC coming up shortly in Washington, D.C. Take care, my friend. Excellent work,
Thank
as
you.
Always.